The Carolinas Invitational on USA Sports at the new Charlotte Coliseum. This afternoon, an exhibition performance by the United States Olympic gymnastics teams. And good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ted Robinson. Welcome to USA Sports continuing coverage of the Carolinas Invitational. A much-needed day of normalcy here at the new Charlotte Coliseum after yesterday's chaos. About 15,000 filing in this afternoon to watch a performance, not a competition, by our Olympics gymnastics teams. There will be no scoring today, hopefully a lot of fun, and you'll get your chance to see up close the gymnasts who are hoping to bring medals back from Seoul in about a month. And that's, of course, not all of our coverage is complete this afternoon. Tonight we're going to the old Charlotte Coliseum as the Olympic boxing team takes on members of the Canadian Olympic team. That will be at 9 Eastern time tonight. Then tomorrow at 6 Eastern, it's Criterium Cycling through the streets of Charlotte with several spots on our Olympic team still up for grabs. And at 7:30 Eastern tomorrow night, the Olympic baseball team concludes its 7-game series with the Cuban national team. But for the next 2 hours this afternoon, sit back, relax, join us, and enjoy gymnastics. And to help bring you the competition, our gymnastics team, Bob Carpenter and Kathy Johnson.
Thank you, Ted. And not that they ever relax too much, but it has been a rather relaxing week for our Olympic team, having come through the trials a week ago. Kathy, of course, a two-time medalist at the 84 Games, the captain of our women's gymnastics team. And Kathy, it has been an interesting week for these gymnasts. And now we scout the women's team, a squad that has a combination of youth and a newcomer leading the way and experience with a veteran.
Well, the United States will be well represented in Seoul. They are led by Phoebe Mills, who rose to the top this year, first in winning the American Cup, then the USA Championships, and finally the Olympic trials just this last week. And also Kelly Garrison-Steeds, the 21-year-old veteran who was second at the trials, and hopefully will provide that experience and leadership that they need. The team is a great combination of youth and experience.
Don Peters resigning Monday as the coach of the women's team, citing the team concept being the most important thing as his reason. The name of Bella Caroli and others remains important in the women's gymnastics picture. We'll further develop that story as the afternoon turns into the evening here in Charlotte. On the men's team, a diverse group of personalities, styles, and approaches to the various events.
Again, the men have a good combination. They have youth, as many of the members are relative newcomers to international competition, and experience. Scott Johnson, 1984 Olympic gold medalist, and then the free spirit, Charles Clay. And I'm sure everybody will see exactly what I mean as they watch the exhibition.
Right now, they're walking onto the floor, the men and the women, to a great ovation for the folks here in Charlotte. A well-deserved ovation after the pressure of the Olympic trials. And now, they get to just show their wares here in Charlotte this afternoon. Ted, it should be a very fun afternoon of gymnastics here in North Carolina.
Well, Bob, it's so important for these young people to relax now. Their competition to make the team is done. We saw last night perhaps a little tension on the basketball team members, knowing there are still 4 cuts to be made before they go to Seoul. Our gymnastics exhibition from the Carolinas Invitational is coming up next. Today's coverage of the Carolinas Invitational is being brought to you by the 1988 U.S. Olympic coins. They help America shine.
Welcome back to the Carolinas Invitational here in Charlotte. A lot of interesting stories in regard to personalities here today. One of them involves Dominic Minicucci, who really didn't know he was going to make the Olympic team till the last moment.
Well, this is what happened. A lady was lining us up to go out, and I knew that they only take 7 guys on the team. I turned around, and I seen a guy behind me, Tom, that I knew I had beat. And I said to myself, there's supposed to be 7 guys going out, and there's somebody behind me. And I says, okay. Now, I looked up in front of me, and I'm trying to see everyone who I thought was ahead of me, and one person was missing. And then I grabbed the lady that was lining everybody up, and I counted the sheet. 1, 2, 3. and then I had no one. And it was tremendous, tremendous feeling.
He's a freshman at the University of Illinois, and pommel horse is his outstanding event, his favorite event, and that's where we will see him starting off our exhibition today, Kath.
Well, he must be a very happy guy, because as that story shows, it was such a great story, and he was definitely the surprise on this Olympic team. Pommel horse is a very unique event. It's often compared to the balance beam in the women's side. It takes a lot of concentration, as you can see. It's very easy to get off on your swing.
In fact, he will take some of the moves that he uses on this apparatus to the parallel bars as well, adapting some of those flares.
I'll tell you what is good about this exhibition right now. It follows a highly pressured weekend in making the Olympic team. And you can see they're down just a little bit here, and they're going to have to realize they got to pick back up.
We'll keep things going right for you as you look at Hope Spivey. She was the number 3 woman in points at the Olympic trials. And Hope Spivey will be performing for us on the uneven bars.
She is one of the most aggressive competitors I've ever seen. She swings quite well on the uneven bars. A full pirouette over the top. A lot of difficulty in here. Nice delta. A little bit of form breaks, but not much. Those are the kind of things you really want to clean up before the games. Another giant pirouette, and that is a miss. She's supposed to go all the way over the top with a full pirouette. I think they're going to learn real quick here that they've got to really get back into concentration following the trials. She's setting up for a dismount. She does the pirouette again, right into a double tuck flyaway.
Hope Spivey out of Suffolk, Virginia, and of course she is performing most lately with Bill and Donna Strauss coaching the Parkettes of Allentown, Pennsylvania. And now we go to Tom Schlesinger, one of these Nebraska Cornhuskers, a senior majoring in chemistry. He's in pre-med, the 87 NCAA all-around champion, and he is very strong in many events, and he will perform for us here on the parallel bars.
He's a very disciplined gymnast. I mean, he's a gymnast. He does everything by the book.
He has a connection to this area, born in Chapel Hill. His father was teaching philosophy, or psychology rather, at North Carolina. And he says because of that, he will always have to be a Tar Heel basketball fan. You can't let those things go away.
He's got a real tough job. He's the alternate for this Olympic team. He's got to be ready to perform at any given moment if someone were to be injured, even in the last 30-second warm-up before the game. He has to go on. Good job by Tom.
Tom Schlesinger, out of that great program at the University of Nebraska. Our exhibition continues here in Charlotte in a moment at the Carolinas Invitational. We're back at the Carolinas Invitational in Charlotte for an exhibition of the Olympic women's and men's gymnastics teams this afternoon. Tonight on USA, guest star E.G. Marshall finds that murder is the best medicine. Don't miss the suspense when Alfred Hitchcock presents tonight at 8, 7 Central. And then tension mounts when a stranger comes to town on the next episode of the Ray Bradbury Theater. That's coming up tonight at 8:30, 7:30 Central on USA. The exhibition continues on the floor and will
Get a look at the floor exercise of Billy Paul, who eased into the number 8 spot when Dan Hayden was injured at the Olympic trials. Certainly a terrible break for Dan, who had the team made, Kathy.
It was a real tough day for Dan. It was on his last event, high bar, and he had injured himself on the event before, separating his shoulder. He had a miss on high bar and unfortunately repeated the skill, which caused another 5-tenths deduction and dropped him out of the team position. This is Billy Paul. He commands a lot of respect. He's been around for ages. He's a strong competitor, and he's always right there. He's never made that top team, the top 6, but he's always in the top 10 or 12.
A couple of alternates for both the women's and the men's team. One gets to go to Seoul, one does not.
Finish. Double back. Nice exercise.
Billy Paul wraps up his first exhibition of the afternoon, and we will move on to the balance beam, where a very powerful young performer out of Tallahassee, Florida, of course now in Houston with her coach Bella Caroli. This is Brandi Johnson.
Brandi has come a long way. She was a junior national champion 2 years ago. She's moved into the elite ranks and now on the Olympic team. She's always been thought of to be one of the strongest vaulters in the country, if not the strongest. Two back handsprings and a layout step up. This is where the United States really needs to buckle down and do well in the Olympic Games. Balance beam usually makes or breaks a team or an individual gymnast. Tremendous concentration. Front tuck, somersault. Couldn't quite get her balance back. This is a good opportunity for these girls and guys to get back into the trials and realize exactly what it's going to take to compete at the game.
In front of a crowd that is on their side, of course, but nevertheless a big crowd, and that pressure that comes along with that type of performance.
It's just enough pressure to get them right where they should be.
Bella Caroli watching one of his outstanding gymnasts in Brandi Johnson.
Now here's that first pass. One of the more difficult passes she does, it's two back handsprings into a layout step out. Slight balance break.
So Brandi walks off. And the youngest member of the men's gymnastics team, an incoming freshman at the University of Nebraska. That's bad news for the rest of the Big Eight and the country. Lance Ringnall, out of Des Moines, Iowa, originally. Lance says he did his first double flip at the age of 8, but we would not suggest getting started that way because he said it was when he was hit by a car. He's been flipping ever since.
A lot of people have been surprised by this guy, but he's really come on strong this past year. He did well at the championship, qualifying into the trials, and maintained his position.
Fifth in the overall at Salt Lake City.
He's doing nice work here. Did a back toss and right into a diamondoff. Front stirrups. Little walk on the hands, but double pike dismount. Very difficult dismount to land.
Lance Ringnall, coached by Ed Birch and Bill Foster, tied for second in two different events at the Olympic trials in Salt Lake City, and here's the dismount.
As I said, this is much more difficult than the double tuck somersault. You get more credit for doing it, but it is harder to land.
Nicely done by Lance, and now a young lady who, in her first major international competition at George Mason University recently, took third at the McDonald's Championships, and she She has got something special. Lots of personality on the floor right now.
And I was there at the American Cup, and I remember this floor routine and how popular it was. Sit back and prepare to be entertained. Watch this first coming right. Round up back handspring, double twist, two back handsprings, three back handsprings into a double back. Stepped out of bounds. It's a lot of tumbling to get into one pass.
No wonder Bella Caroli calls her a showgirl like Mary Lou Retton was.
This is the kind of energy you want when you get up in the morning. Exactly what you're going to have to do to be able to be competitive with the Soviets in Romania. They're going to be doing that tumbling pass at the end of the routines. Last tumbling pass. Nice high double back. Delightful.
All 4'8", 74 pounds of her. Now training out of Houston with Bella Caroli and company, Shelley Stack.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, we present our women's vaulting team.
And she has quite a bit of difficulty in this routine, particularly this middle pass. Does a pike, full twist and double back. A full twist on the first somersault, and then a back pike on the second. And she ends very strong with a high double somersault.
Well, you've seen her, and in a moment, you'll be able to hear from her. Shelley Stack joins Kathy Johnson when we return to Charlotte in a moment. Well, we have a couple of delightful performers together as Kathy Johnson joins Shelley Stack.
Good job, Shelley. It's a beautiful routine. You have really moved up fast these last 6 months from the junior ranks and then finished third at the American Cup. And I remember your interview there. You said you hoped to perform well enough to prove that you could be on the Olympic team. Is that when it really started that you knew you had a shot?
Yeah, after that interview at the American Cup and finishing so high, I just sort of figured out that, you know, I'm beginning to, you know, compete with everybody else up at the senior level. And that really, you know, makes you feel better. So you have enough confidence to know that you can make it to the Olympics, which I did.
What are your expectations, both of the team and of yourself at the Olympic Games?
Well, I think we have a really strong team going into the Olympics. And I think we can, if we work really hard, we can come home with a gold because everybody's really confident of themselves together. And me, I'm just, you know, going to go out and do my best. And hopefully, I know I can come home with a gold on bars.
Great. Thank you. And we'll be right back with more gymnastics.
Next up here in Charlotte, a young lady out of the University of Oklahoma. And we are fortunate enough to be joined by Kelly Garrison, Steve's coach. Welcome, Becky Buick.
Thank you.
And your young lady was the number 2 point maker at the trials last week as we watched Kelly in action on the balance beam. Let's talk a little bit about her performance that got her to the Olympic team.
Okay. So the mounting with a round off tuck salto on. Pretty solid, just maybe a little bit short. That's what I'd like.
Now I understand Kelly's really been working hard on her physical conditioning.
That's right. Strength and conditioning coach for the football team, Pete Martinelli, has been helping us since we returned from World Championships. She's been in the weight room with the football players, and I must say she's gained a lot of recognition and a lot of support from that team.
Now, it might be my own personal opinion, but I think balance beam is just Kelly's event.
It really is. It has been since she was a child, since she was 10. A little error there, just not pushing quite enough off the feet.
But what about the possible role of leadership, Becky, that she could have on this team, being the so-called senior member?
I think much like Kathy, Kelly does have leadership qualities to bring into this team. If the young girls need any questions answered, Kelly will be there to answer to them. She is considered the mama of the team.
I can definitely relate to feeling like the mommy, but I think I actually became the grandmother of the team. How has being married affected her training at all?
It's been great for Kelly. It's really made her organized and really set her goals a little bit better. So I wish all my girls were married.
Well, husband
and
Mark.
And a nicer team.
That's right, thank you.
Husband Mark is on the Oklahoma gymnastics team and is a pretty good athlete himself. And there is Kelly Garrison Steves. Becky, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Next, we look at Kevin Davis. He will be performing on the pommel horse. Another one of these Nebraska Cornhuskers, a three-year member of the senior national team. He was third in the all-around, but first on the pommel horse at the trials in Salt Lake City.
Kevin is outstanding all around, but really, I think this event is his. He does such beautiful work here. I think you'll be able to notice how high he swings above the horse, how straight his body is. Nice work traveling down the horse. Beautiful flares. He moves so easily across the horse. Nice scissor work. Down to the end of the horse, up to a handstand for the dismount. Beautiful job.
Kevin Davis has been a big factor in the NCAA championships, and now he, of course, is on the national and the international level as well. Kevin Davis, originally from Charleston, South Carolina, and another look at those flares.
Competing for Nebraska has really helped Kevin. He's become much more consistent, and his work has just been refined. There's a dismount.
And now on the floor, considered the number one gymnast of the females in the USA, is Phoebe Mills, coached by Bella Caroli. And Bella, thanks for being with us as we watch your number one attraction in action right now.
Bella, you've continually been able to coach girls up to a higher level. What do you stress in your workouts to really achieve that?
Well, probably just like we see that now, Phoebe on the beam. The seriousness, the sturdiness, the powerful actions, the dedication, and at the same time the confidence, I can do it, sure I will do it. And that's so important ingredient of the high performers. Now I strongly feel we have a unique situation, what we never had before, beam. Beam is a so important event of all these big competition games or world championships. And now we have 3-4 beamers, unbelievable kids. I never can recall one country in my life who they're having 3 or 4 like we have right now. That's a great opportunity to achieve high performances on this specific event of the Seoul coming up games. And I know with Kelly, with Phoebe, even Christy or Rhonda on the team, they could put up a tremendous and almost unbeatable team in the beam.
I had said that earlier, and I've always said it.
Right.
Beam is always a key
to
how the team finishes.
At the beginning like that one, she wasn't a great beamer, but she sure grew into it.
Nice double back. Good job.
We'll have another look at the artistry, the confidence of Phoebe Mills coming on the beam and off the beam with her outstanding dismount.
You said the key right there, confidence. Phoebe has just unbelievable confidence now going into the Olympic Games.
Bella, thank you so much for joining us while we watch your star pupil in action. And we'll talk a little bit later about the USA women's gymnastics coaching situation as we look forward to Seoul. More coming up from Charlotte in just a moment. USA continues its coverage of the Carolinas Invitational from Charlotte. Today we're featuring the exhibition of the women's and men's gymnastics teams as they tune up for the Olympics in Seoul, Korea. And now down to the floor where Kathy Johnson is standing by with Kelly Garrison Steves, a couple of ladies who have shared similar roles on their Olympic teams. Phoebe Mills is also there as well.
Thanks, Bob. Phoebe Mills and Kelly Garrison Steves are at this time the two leading forces for the United States team leading up to the games in Seoul. And they both have very different things to add to the team. Kelly Garrison is 21. She has a lot of experience. Phoebe Mills, only 15 years old, but she's pretty much a veteran to international competition as well. Phoebe, you're going into your second major international meet, the Olympic Games. How will this differ from the World Championships last year?
I guess the meet format will probably be a lot like the World Championships, and I'm sure I learned a lot from it in order to prepare me for this competition. It's the Olympics, it's the big one, so there's more pressure, but I'm sure that I'll just go out and have fun and do well.
What about Phoebe Mills? How much better are you this year than you were last year at the Games?
I think I'm a lot better than I was last year because I was injured and I was really having a rough year. Right now I feel good and my workouts have been going really well, so I'm just ready to go out there and go for it.
And Kelly Garrison Steve, after trying out for three Olympic teams, you're finally an Olympian in 1988. That's got to feel great.
Yes, it's just a dream come true. After trying so many times and not making it, I think it's more prestigious for me, and I'm just a lot more grateful for making this team.
What would you contribute to this year's success?
Mainly just rearrangement of my diet and my training schedule. I've just really worked on cross training and lifting weights and just rearranging my diet completely from snacking on a candy bar to eating three meals a day.
What do you think the U.S. chances are in Seoul?
I think that we have a really good chance of possibly winning a medal. Of course, we're all going to have the most outstanding performance, probably the best one of our lives, and every single one of us, but I do think we have a great chance of possibly taking third place.
Thank you, Kelly and Phoebe, and we'll be back in just a few minutes.
Okay, so far? Here at the Carolinas Invitational, women's and men's gymnastics. It's an exhibition here on this Saturday afternoon, and we'll get our first look at rhythmic gymnastics. You're looking at Diane Simpson out of Evanston, Illinois. She's a freshman at Northwestern University at the age of 19. And this, of course, has been a gold medal sport since 1984 in LA. And Kathy Johnson, this is an event that combines many different things.
Well, instead of working on the apparatus as an artistic gymnastic, they use apparatus. They toss and catch. Flexibility plays a huge part in this sport. Dance, elegance. Typically, the Eastern Europeans have dominated the sport. The Bulgarians, the Soviets. But this gymnast has done particularly well in world competition. Has brought the standard up in USA gymnastics.
Often called a mixture of ballet, gymnastics, and a bit of juggling. It's been popular in Europe for many decades.
There's also a little bit of theater in there. You can see the drama, the facial expression.
And one thing's for sure, Kathy, now that medals are available, it'll become very popular in this country in a short period of time.
It's already beginning to pick up popularity. Many young girls are going into rhythmic.
Diane was the all-around title winner at the 86th U.S. Olympic Festival, even though she was performing with a broken finger at the time.
An interesting twist at the Olympic trials. She and her teammate, Michelle Berube, tied for first place at the trials, both qualifying for the Olympic team. Michelle Berube, of course, was on the 84 team, and this will be Diane's first Olympic. It was a beautiful job.
Diane Simpson with a look at rhythmic gymnastics.
It takes tremendous eye-hand coordination for the tosses. Each of the tosses have difficulty ratings, depending on what they do below the toss and what the equipment actually does in the air. You can see her extreme flexibility. She's always right there to catch the hoop.
Beautifully done by Diane Simpson. And a big story in gymnastics over the last several years. In September of 86, at the age of 14, when they asked, is she the next Mary Lou? Christy Phillips was the youngest ever to appear on the cover of Sports Illustrated. And her well-documented comeback attempt. She is an alternate that will not be traveling to Seoul if things stay the way they are right now. Number eight position on the team.
The United States Gymnastics Federation, though, is pushing hard for that eighth member. And I feel pretty good about the possibilities of her traveling to Seoul, because I know from firsthand experience that sometimes because of an injury, we need that extra gymnast right there to step into the alternate spot.
Well, speaking of injuries, Do Yamashiro, about 9 days before the trials, had a bad ankle injury and she could not compete. That gave Christy Phillips the opportunity.
Same thing happened with Sabrina Marr.
Congenital
back problem. And a
couple of Don Peters gymnasts that did not make the Olympic team.
Setting up for a middle tumble run. This is a new floor routine for Christy. Double twist, punch front. She tumbles right back in the other direction. Knee back handspring. Full twist, punch front. Nice combination.
The tumbles in one direction and then the other, Kathy, are becoming very popular.
It's definitely the trend of the future. Her last tumbling pass and a double twist. It's a nice new routine for her.
Christy Phillips, of course, with that big smile, has always had tremendous presence on the floor. Crowds have always related to her in that respect.
Now watch this middle tumbling run. It's actually two runs combined. She does a double twist, punch into a front somersault, rebounds and goes right back in the other direction. Takes a lot of endurance. And again, another punch front somersault.
Christy Phillips, hopefully headed to Seoul. And we'd like to introduce a gentleman who at many different levels, many different locations, has coached many of our Olympic men's gymnasts, and that is A.B. Grossfeld, the head coach of the men's team. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much.
And also including the 1984 men's Olympic team gold, which has to be a highlight for you and all the guys.
Certainly was.
Right now on the floor, as A.B. will comment for us, our first look on the parallel bars, that's Scott Johnson.
A.B., are you counting on Scott to be a stabilizing force as
oh, yeah.
a team leader?
Yeah, he's our team leader and certainly our most experienced on the team. Scott aggravated his hand slightly at the trials last week, so he'll most likely do a modified routine today.
Now in 84, he was the leadoff man in all the events. I'm sure that's
right.
going to be different this year.
Right, he'd probably be near the end of most events. There's a, we call that a peach basket. He would flip underneath the bar, and there's a forward swing and pirouette. That's called a stutz, which is a German word. And this is a backup right straddle cut L, which he never uses, but he's modifying his routine. That's why he had a little wobble.
And in finishing second at the all-around in Salt Lake City, he did tie for first in this event.
Right, he's tremendous on that. Got a double cut. He's still nursing that hand of his a little bit.
Also, I think what's interesting to note is in 84, it was the first three gymnasts that went up in the lineup that really made the difference in terms of the team victory going head-to-head with the Chinese.
That's right.
Do you see that happening here in Seoul, or what do you think the key will be to a good team success?
The whole team this time. Last time, the real key was the last three scores, but this time it's going to be like a total team effort.
A.B., stick with us for a moment because we'll be seeing Charles Lakes in a few moments. Right now, more rhythmic gymnastics with Michelle Ferrubi. Michelle, of course, we mentioned her a moment ago when Diane Simpson was on the floor. Michelle is from Rochester, Michigan.
Now Michelle competed in 1984 at the Olympic Games, which it was the first Olympics that they had rhythmic gymnastics. She took some time off, but basically decided to retire. She made the decision to come back, and it was a good decision at that.
In rhythmic gymnastics, we've seen the hoop. We remember seeing the ribbon. You also could see a rope, clubs, the ball, any different apparatus that they can operate with, as Kathy mentioned a few moments ago.
This is a very exotic look, and she uses it very well with her expression. Also, her music choice goes right along with it.
Maybe this particular apparatus the most attractive of all of them in terms of visual effects out there on the floor.
I have to say it's my favorite event of all the events. They have four apparatus that they use. Beautiful routine.
Michelle Perubi in our second look at rhythmic gymnastics. Charlie Lakes is coming up in a moment. And just the mention of that name seems to bring smiles to people's faces.
Well, I said it at Pan American Games that he is a gymnast that likes to play gymnastics. He's very, very talented. And in fact, I've heard his work habits are a little bit different than some of the other gymnasts. Why don't you tell us about that?
Well, Charlie, I've never seen Charlie upset. He works real hard, but he works very quick. And sometimes Charlie needs to do more than he does because he does a lot of things easy, but he's certainly a performer that can raise anybody to their feet. He's very dynamic, explosive, and he's extremely talented, and sometimes he doesn't perform up to his best, but he certainly got ready for the trials, and he won our U.S. Olympic final trials. It was a really difficult tumbling pass, a 1 3/4 running front somersault, and an Arabian 1 3/4 somersault, one pass, very hard. There's a very flighty fall, and a punch one that's rather satisfying.
He was first in the all-around at Salt Lake City. Also duplicated that on the high bar, what he says is his favorite event. Parallel bars he likes as well. Well, he was up near the top in many different events, showing his versatility in the Olympic trials.
Well, we'll be counting real highly on Charlie at the Olympic Games, since he is our champion, and certainly he's one of our leaders also, behind Scott.
And a nice high tuck double back this week.
And that's what we want to see, a nice stick at the end.
A.B., thank you so much. All the best in Seoul, and we're enjoying watching your gentlemen perform today.
Thank you very much.
A.B. Grossfeld, the head coach of the men's Olympic gymnastics team. Next up is a very special story that took place a week ago. Living in Salt Lake City, competing and making the Olympic team in Salt Lake City, Melissa Marlowe. She was actually born in Belgium, but boy, the folks in Salt Lake had the banners out. There was pressure on her, Kathy, to win at her own venue a week ago, and she got it done.
You couldn't have written a better script for a more exciting Olympic trials, and particularly for missing. Came down right to the last event. This is a beautiful event for her. Look at the long line in her swing. Her toe point is just gorgeous. Reverse hecht. She's got all the difficulty in the routine as well. And dismount. It's a nice culminating dismount.
16-year-old Melissa Marlowe out of Salt Lake City. So the folks here in Charlotte are enjoying what they've seen so far. And in a moment, we'll tackle again the issue of the U.S. Olympic women's gymnastics team and that coaching situation. Welcome back to Charlotte. The women's and men's gymnastics team exhibiting their skills for us here this afternoon. Bob Carpenter back with Kathy Johnson. Kathy, as we mentioned earlier, there's been a big change as far as the coaching of the women's team in the last week since the trials.
Well, there's always been debate on how the team should be coached, whether it should be the individual coaches or to have a national team coach. This year, the controversy was that it became public. And, Bella Caroli really pushed the issue that Don Peters shouldn't be the coach. And it went so far that Don just felt he should resign for the better of the team and to allow them to win the medals he thinks they're capable of doing.
So that happened on Monday of the past week. And right here in Charlotte, as some of the coaches gather for the Olympics preparation, Kathy had a chance to talk to them about the situation from the coach's view.
Well, first of all, Kathy, I was an ardent Don Peters supporter. I felt very comfortable with Don coaching Missy, and I know that Missy felt very comfortable with Don coaching her. Felt like we needed a one leader on the floor that could unify the team.
I think the whole situation is unfortunate. However, by the time we get to the Olympic Games, if we're not prepared by then it's too late anyway, and I think we'll all be ready to do our job regardless of who's the coach.
I think it allows us to really stay in touch with our athletes throughout the games, and it's going to allow our athletes to stay on their same schedules. You know, the schedules that got them on the Olympic team will be maintained, and so therefore they don't have to really make any coaching adjustments into the games.
Probably the major problem might be the lineup. I think that we have a pretty fair system worked out, so hopefully we'll get through that without any problem. The individual coaches have to be able to work together. We have to swallow ego and work for what's best for the United States.
My answer probably you know and everybody knows, because I was fighting for that very, very hard. And I believe that's the system that's going to take us a step, big step forward. I'm talking about not the present. I'm talking for the future. And I'm talking to all those individual, young and talented coaches who are out there and who are just waiting for the sign, or real sign, to turn them on and to produce and push themselves to produce a national team member. Then they're going to get the major professional satisfaction being named national team coaches.
And as you saw on the graphic, he is the coach of five of the eight members of our women's gymnastics Olympic team. We'll hear more from Bella as we see more of his girls in action in a moment. Welcome back to Charlotte on what has to be an afternoon of celebration of sorts, as the Olympic team has been picked. They are getting ready for a competition in Seoul. Bella Caroli certainly is a big part of that, with five of the eight girls. And Bella, welcome back, and thank you for joining us. First of all, what is your reaction to what happened in the last week in regard to the resignation of Don Peters? Your reaction to that action?
Well, actually, that's not make me happy, seeing somebody resign for whatever reason. But sure makes me happy knowing now the kids are having coaches behind them who are preparing them previously, who really help them to get to that point to be competitive, and that's categorically toward the best interest of the athletes. Knowing another fact, I believe, you know, is we really done a tremendous step forward. Disappearing a position which was held for a long, long time from very certain people. Now there is an open field for all those young coaches who are out there and willing to work hard and to get the major satisfaction on their life professionally, to be out and assist their own kids, and at the same time to get the title national team coaches. I believe the national pride and the professional motivation is going to be tremendous, which is going to finalize with excellent performers, good kids, and very competitive international performances.
Okay, now from a serious subject to one that is pretty much fun, and that is watching Shelley Stack.
Well, that's always fun. Watching Shelley, no question of that. She's a little bubbling, a little thingy who has her own personality. Better ones.
Is she the same in workout as she is in competition? She's so aggressive and seems so excited to be doing gymnastics.
That's exactly what comes through, her little personality, a little thingy.
The bubbly kid who also has the huge excitement of joy, of tremendous satisfaction what she does. She always does in that most positive way. I always love him.
What about some of the other girls on this Olympic team, Bella? Most notably those that you are most intimately involved with, the five.
Well, all five of them are different. And it's exciting to work with them, even though sometimes you really have to adjust your personality and your methods according to their own personality. Like Brandy, very physical, extremely powerful. But sure, you have to watch very carefully, because she's a little bit fragile, still fragile on the outgoing aspect, on the aggressiveness. You have to adjust always and all your methods to be just proper to her. Shelly? Oh, you can play with her. She's a little game, you know, you can feel like a little toy. Always you can have satisfaction, but at the same time, hard worker.
Well, we're looking out toward the floor.
Right.
She is going to perform for us right now.
Well, you can see the power pack here, and you can see a tremendous physical performance.
What do you consider her best event? Would it be vaulting or floor?
Probably vaulting and floor. Both of them are powerful events of her, based on her tremendous physical strength and explosiveness.
I've heard many people say that her compulsory vault could be the best in the world.
Well, I would consider certainly.
What has she had to work the most on in these past few months?
Probably a beam and the bars. They were the two events where she needed to have more work and more consistency. I believe now she's getting to the hole. Look out. Oh, my
oh,
God.
Beautiful pike, full twisting double back.
Well, that's all about when you can come out and perform something so physical, so powerful, that's impressive. No matter what kind of other combinations you are having, but with this type of high difficulty performances, you are impressing, no matter public and judges alike. And she's a good dancer too. It's a very pleasant personality on the floor.
This is a fairly new floor routine for her.
Oh, yeah.
Whip over through the double back. She has all the difficulty that she needs. Are you planning on making any changes before the games in her routine?
Small changes we're going to do, especially on the dance floor, dance combination. We might introduce a few little flowers in it, which might give her a little more credibility as good dancer too, not just powerful tumbler. Now look at that, my tumbling pass is for last pass. For this mount is extremely difficult. Pulling back out and she almost nailed it. Even over rotated. That is something for them.
It's what it's gonna take to be competitive with
right.
Eastern Europeans.
Right.
I think explosiveness, the key word that Bella mentioned a few moments ago, the explosiveness along with the talent, that's something that will really get noticed on an international level.
Look at the power in this.
But
super lift off the floor, and she still continues to rise throughout the somersault.
Beautifully done. Bella, thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
More coming up from Charlotte at the Carolinas Invitational on USA. Welcome back to Charlotte. We're watching at the new Charlotte Coliseum here, the Carolina's Invitational version of women's and men's gymnastics. The Olympic trials a week ago. The team has been formed on both the men and the women's side. And today we're just celebrating the fact that they did make it. They're ready for Seoul. And some principal performers are involved. It'll be there at Seoul. Scott Johnson is the number two overall man from the Olympic trials. He's with Kathy Johnson.
Hi, I'm here with Scott, and Scott is the leader of this team. He was number two at the Olympic trials, and now he's a two-time Olympian. He's a gold medalist in 1984. How do these Olympics differ for you?
Well, of course, I'm very, very excited about it. There was no question that the 84 Olympic Games was great, winning a gold medal and everything, but that, you know, once that was over, I set my sights on 1988, and I thought that it was going to be over for me when I broke my hand about 2 months ago. And I'm just so excited that I was able to bounce back from that and still make the Olympic team. So this is my second Olympian. I like the phrase, two-time Olympian. I'm really psyched about it.
Well, how is your hand doing and how will it be in Seoul?
Well, you know, it's doing really well. I still got to be kind of careful about, you know, my training schedule and the type of pressure that I exert on it. But it's pretty much 100%. I just want to make sure that I don't get hurt again. I want to win another medal at these next Olympic Games.
What are your expectations for the team and you as an individual?
Well, I think we got a really strong team. We have a young team, a little less experienced than the team we had in 1984, but they're a tough team. They're a great bunch of guys. I think if we're real healthy and hit 100%, I think we do have a chance at a medal. Myself, personally, well, first of all, I want to do good for the team. Second of all, I'm going to do the best I can so that I can win an individual medal.
Thank you, Scott. And here on my right, we have the guy who finished number one at the Olympic trials, Charles Lake. And you're the guy, I don't know if you know it, but I've been calling you the free spirit of the team.
Ah.
You have a little bit different attitude going into competition, and it just seems like you're really enjoying yourself.
Yeah, you know, I think of gymnastics more as a performance than the competition aspects of it. I love to just kind of play to the crowd, and I think the judges enjoy that as well.
What do you think will be your strength that you can add to the team going to Seoul?
I hope the dynamicism of my routines add a little life to the team, if anything.
How do you work on consistency? Because I've heard you have short workouts and you get them over with, but yet you showed your consistency at the trials.
Well, actually, at the beginning of a training period, I'll do a lot of routines to get to a point where I can do the shorter quantity workouts and higher quality.
Oh, great. Thanks. You look super, and good luck in Seoul. And we'll be back in a few minutes after these messages.
We are at the Carolinas Invitational, a weekend of sports excitement here on USA, and this afternoon we're featuring women's and men's gymnastics. Tuesday night on USA is something we call Comedy Night. Join the fun with Gary Shandling, Joan Rivers, and Benny Hill. It all starts at 8 Eastern, 7 Central on USA. Back to our anchor position now. Here is Ted Robinson.
All right, Bob, thank you. We still have about another hour of gymnastics coming up. You will see exactly what Charles Lakes talked about, what he hopes to add to the Olympic team. The dynamic routine coming up on the high bar, and you'll see Phoebe Mills, the number one women's finisher in the all-around gymnastics. She'll be on the floor exercise. But, of course, we're just beginning our weekend here at the Carolinas Invitational. More Olympic action comes up tonight. We'll shift uptown to the old Charlotte Coliseum at 9 Eastern, joining Al Albert, Sean O'Grady, and Mark Freeland as the United States Olympic boxing team takes on members of the Canadian Olympic team, although some minor injuries are robbing the U.S. team of some competitors this weekend. Four now of the 12 boxers suffering minor injuries will not compete this weekend. Then tomorrow we go to cycling. It's a criterium race, a road race through the streets of downtown Charlotte. There are still some spots left in our U.S. Olympic team. They may be up for grabs tomorrow at 6 Eastern. And at 7:30 Eastern, the United States Olympic baseball team will play the final game of its series against the Cuban national team. And the Cubans have been tough, picking up right where they left off when they won the Pan Am Games last year. They've given the Americans all they want during the seven-game series thus far. When we continue with our gymnastics exhibition here in Charlotte, we'll see Scott Johnson on the floor exercise right after these messages.
The Carolinas Invitational featuring gymnastics this afternoon, and we'll get a look at Scott Johnson, the leader, if you will, of the U.S. Olympic team in gymnastics, the men's squad. He was second in the all-around at Salt Lake City a week ago, and Kathy Johnson, we'll get a look at Scott operating here on the floor exercise.
Scott is one of the most talented gymnasts I've ever known.
7 years on the senior national team and 22 total medals in his years of competing in the U.S. Olympic Festival, more than any other ever.
This is one of my favorite events for Scott. So springy. Full in, he just went right off the mat. Again, those are things that you really got to work hard not to do at the games, because every tenth of a point counts. Every step or out of bounds or falter or balance break is a tenth of a point off, or maybe two. Dive roll right into a straddle jump. There's this balance requirement, scale. And last tumbling run, double tuck and a perfect landing. Exactly what you want to do in competition.
Scott Johnson will not have to do much more than that to perform at his optimum. Another one of those great gymnast operating out of Lincoln, Nebraska. More coming up from Charlotte in a moment on USA. The Carolinas Invitational on USA continues, and joining us, Bob Carpenter, Kathy Johnson, and Mark Lee from the Rocky Mountain Gymnastics. And you were very proud of the way that Melissa Marlowe got things done in the old hometown of Salt Lake City last Saturday.
Well, we certainly were. She performed very well in front of her home crowd. We were all very excited, and I'm sure there were about 10,000 people in there that were just really rooting for her.
And it's not like she had things clinched at the start. She started and ended in the number six position.
Well, actually, she started the meet in number 11 and then moved up to six and then held on, and it was very exciting.
I think it's only appropriate that we bring you up here right before she's getting ready to go on balance beam, since that was her last event at the Olympic trials, and she needed, what, a 9-6, I believe, to clinch the spot on the Olympic team, and she came through.
Yeah, she did. Beam has a tendency to be her nemesis. She has lost a few meets because of what happened on balance beam, and it was kind of ironic that she was going to end on balance beam at trials. It was going to be the make or break, and boy, she came through.
Mark, stay with us. We'll see Missy performing in just a moment. But first, a quick switch over to the men's team, where Kevin Davis will be performing for us on the high bar.
Kevin's always exciting in competition, and again here on high bar. I have to say here, I trained with Kevin for many years at Atlanta School of Gymnastics, so I've known him since he was about 12 or 13 years old and watched him really progress, and he's come a long, long way. Beautiful reverse heck from one arm. Nice extended swing. Nice jam through the handstand. Ankle drive. Preparing for his dismount. And a double layout. Gone a little bit easy there.
Well, Kevin Davis is the one who told me that for the last week, they've been in the gym acting like gymnasts, but he doesn't have to try very hard. He is outstanding on the big bar.
Here's a beautiful move, a one-arm reverse heck. Well, it's really tough coming off the Olympic trials. I'm going to take a look at his dismount. This is where he took it a little bit easy. Kind of open pike and then open into layout. Now, as I was saying, coming off Olympic trials is so tough that next week, he said, it saps you of all your adrenaline, all your excess energy, and he went in the gym, tried to do a straddle jump, which is a very basic move, and it was hard.
Yeah, he did take a couple of days off, he did acknowledge, and got away from things, got back after it around Wednesday of this week, knowing that this exhibition was coming up on Saturday. You saw Mark Lee sitting with us, and here is his protege, Melissa Marlowe.
She mounts with a press, and then moves into a planche.
She is so beautiful on this event, and this is one of the reasons. Look at the flexibility. The beautiful toe point.
Mark, did you two talk last week about what it would take for her to win, or at least make the team, because she had so much of that local pressure in Salt Lake City?
Well, we trained for that. Every single day in the gym, we did one routine that was simulated for trials. And we stopped the entire gym, we pulled all the classes, and we made them surround the event. And they would scream her name and cheer. We pulled people off the street for that, those fun routines. And so for 3 weeks, she performed one routine on every event in front of a crowd that was actually very obnoxious. So she was used to having quite a few people paying a lot of attention to her.
And thus, she was pretty focused by the time the big time came.
Yeah, I think that there was nothing, after that 3 weeks of training, there was nothing that could have distracted her.
Beautiful balance and flexibility. This is an event where Missy is so beautiful on it, but yet at times she's had trouble here, and I understand you have Tammy Biggs in the gym, and she's done a tremendous job.
Tammy Biggs is one of the very, very best, and she has really helped Missy Marlowe.
Taking a little easy on the dismount, and I don't blame her. It's so important at this time, this close on to the Olympic Games, to not take any chances whatsoever for injury. She's come a long way on this event. Back handspring, layout step out. Really works the landing.
Yeah, we did. We played it a little bit safe on the dismount here. We haven't worked out real hard this week. We wanted to come down a little bit, so we toned the dismount down just a little bit and played a little safe so we can start training next week.
Well, Mark Lee, thank you so much for joining us, and good luck to you and Missy as you get ready for the big show across over in Seoul.
Well, we're looking for it very much.
Okay, that's Mark Lee. We'll return to Charlotte in a moment with more gymnastics exhibitions from the Carolinas Invitational. Well, back here in Charlotte, a little interlude in the action, and the men are doing a vault exhibition for us. We just saw Scott Johnson go flying through the air after Charlie Lakes did the same. And we'll get a look at some of the performers on the other side of the floor.
Well, they're giving the audience the all-around flavor. They're showing some of the vaulting events.
There's Wes Suter.
Handspring front vault.
They call him the big guy, and he's 5'10", 160.
Which is very big for a gymnast. Most of the gymnasts, the male gymnasts, range between anywhere from 5'3 to 5'5 or 5'6. There are some that are 5'7.
Dominic Minicucci. So we've seen a Cornhusker and now one of those Fighting Illini on the ball. Charlie Lakes is next. What a flamboyant performer he is. He has a hobby of drawing cartoons. In fact, he's done some of it commercially and has been rather successful.
Beautiful handspring front pike. Excellent landing.
He also has a recording studio in his home. He obviously is a very diverse young man in terms of interests that take up his time. Another look at Scott Johnson.
Layout Tukaha. A lot of hype on the ball.
Looking down again at Wes Suter. And of course, anytime you talk about the gymnast from Lincoln, Nebraska, Kathy, you have to mention Francis Allen, the great coach at the university there. And what an outstanding program they've built over the years with scholarships, equipment, and now great athletes. Jim Hartung, of course, is one who stayed home and helped establish that program.
Definite powerhouse in gymnastics. Both Francis Allen and Jim Howard do an excellent job there. They balance each other very well in the gym. One's the taskmaster and the other keeps everybody going.
Don Minicucci, who thought he was going to be an alternate, but found out late he had made the team. Here's Charlie Lakes again.
Layout super hard.
And looks like one more from Scott Johnson. He's 27 now. Last go round for this guy.
Yeah, I read in an interview that he said after the 88 games, this old boy is retiring. Layout Tukaha with a full twist and beautifully done.
Well, throughout some of the breaks in the action this afternoon, the folks here in Charlotte have been entertained thus with vaulting exhibitions by the women and now the men. Very entertaining to watch, and it's just simply a great weekend of amateur sporting activity here in Charlotte, North Carolina. Boxing tonight on USA, cycling tomorrow, Olympic baseball. We've already had basketball. The parallel bars we focus in on now, and the number eight man on the team is Billy Paul.
And again, like Wes, he's very, very big to gymnast. Surprisingly, he does these skills very easily. Diamandoff, little leg separation there. Interesting original move there. Front flip catch. Back toss to handstand. Right into it. Double tuck flyaway.
Pat on the shoulder from A.B. Grossfeld, the coach. Another look at the dismount of Billy Paul.
Billy's done gymnastics for many, many years now. Represented the United States all over the world.
Well, you talked about his size and power. And next up, we'll see a young lady that possesses some of those same attributes. Rhonda Fain out of Coon Rapids, Minnesota, 5'5", 115 pounds. She's a tremendous vaulter. And now we see her perform on the uneven bars.
She's also very good on this event, especially for a tall gymnast. She's 5'5". I know that doesn't sound tall to some people, but it's very tall. Beautiful combination. Two giants with full pirouettes over the top, right into a reverse heft. Very aggressive in competition. Another full pirouette. Into her dismount, a double twist from a high bar right over the low bar. Very unique and exciting dismount.
And that is the number one alternate. She will be going to Seoul as the number seven member of the team. Rhonda Fain. She threw a couple of tens up on the board in vaulting at Salt Lake City last week, but look at her action on the uneven bars.
Watch this, it's so beautiful. Double twist right over the low bar. It's more of a daredevil move, and the crowd always loves it.
Proudly wearing the stars and stripes, one of the best received moves by the crowd here today. More coming up from Charlotte as the Carolinas Invitational continues on USA. We're going to do more gymnastics here as the Olympic team gets ready for Seoul at the Carolinas Invitational in Charlotte. Kevin Davis says this guy ought to be on the cover of GQ. This is Wes Suter. Floor exercise.
This is a great event for Wes. Full twist and double back. He's very clean here.
Kathy, we talked earlier about his size, 5'10", 160, the tallest of the U.S. team. How does that make things different for him?
Well, any time the body is larger, it's going to rotate slower. It's much easier to rotate quick when you're a small body. But as long as you keep your strength up to your size, it's no problem. That middle pass he did was wonderful.
Oh, yes. Fourth in the all-around at Salt Lake City, also in the floor exercise. The horizontal bars, his best event there, tied for second in finishing fourth overall.
He really came up strong this past year. He dropped a little bit in the rankings the year before, but he's right back up to fourth. Nice double tuck somersault at the end.
Wes Suter, coached by those Nebraska connections, Francis Allen and Jim Howard. He's an 87 graduate of the University of Nebraska.
Next, we're going to bring up a young lady who has built her floor exercise routine around the Broadway musical Cats.
It's a really nice pass. 1.5 twists. Punch front, punch right into a full twisting dive roll. It's very unique.
And the flow of their routine.
Out of Allentown, Pennsylvania, we welcome the coach of Hope Spivey. There's Hope. Donna Strauss is with us. Hope was number three in the all-around last weekend at Salt Lake City. Even though she had a little problem on the beam that day, she did very well in the other events.
Yes, she was very strong in all of her events. Compulsory beam, she scored 9.9 and unfortunately had the fall during optional beam. I think the tension was really building at that point, but then she came back strong on the floor exercise.
At least at that time, she was in a fairly comfortable position as far as making the top six.
Yes, she was in third and she maintained her third place.
What I've really noticed as a change in Hope is her physical conditioning. It seems to me you've really worked hard on that.
We did. She had a back injury in the fall, and so we had to stop working out a little bit. And instead, we concentrated our efforts on the flexibility and the strength, and she worked very hard, and I think that it shows.
This is the second year she's done this routine, and it's really evolved into a nice routine for her.
Yeah, the choreography is very good. It looks a little bit like it came off the New York Broadway stage.
Full twisting double back.
You can see on her face, this is her favorite event. She really enjoys it. She really gets into the routine.
Just a little tumbling around. Front through to a double tuck. Look how high she gets up off the floor. She's so quick. Must be like that in the gym.
She is. Every day is pretty profitable. She works 100%. She kind of set her goals and she knew what she had to do to attain them.
But there was a time when she was a little unsure about some of those goals.
There was. She wasn't quite confident enough, I think, that she thought she could do it. But now that she's pursued it, she's really an excited young lady.
Well, the confidence is definitely back and you can see it.
Thanks.
Tremendous job.
Hope Spivey. From the Parkettes of Allentown, Pennsylvania. Another look at some of the best features of that floor exercise.
Our next performer has, for a long time, had
What do you feel are her strengths and weaknesses going into the games?
Well, I think her strength is her power and her determination. And we're working really hard. The compulsory beam at trials was an outstanding performance for her. And so we're going to work really hard and consistently on optional beam. And that's what her goal is, to go in there and hit 8 for 8.
Well, if everybody on the team went out and hit 8 for 8, I think the United
States would do it.
Donna, thank you so much for joining us, and a good look at Hope Spivey. And now, in his favorite event, the still rings, here is Scott Johnson.
And I don't know if you can hear the music in the background. The music is Diana Ross, I Want Muscles. It's very appropriate for this event. It's an event that requires a lot of strength, a lot of balance. This is really one of his best events. He is so steady on the rings. Back giant goes right up to that handstand.
Well, it's the one he calls his favorite. He was second in the all-around at Salt Lake City and in this event. He tied for first in the parallel bars at Salt Lake City.
Nice half and half out, pike position. Very strong routine for him. Should be a good routine for him in the Olympic Games. Nice high half and half out, and again in pike position, makes it much more difficult.
Scott Johnson, the man they look to for leadership, the veteran member at the age of 27 on the men's team. Meanwhile, similar situation with this lady on the women's team, Kelly Garrison Steves. At the age of 21, a senior at the University of Oklahoma, majoring in communications.
We're ready to go now with our next
9 years with the senior national team. You know, she started in 1974, about a year after some of the U.S. Olympic team female gymnasts were born.
I know that feeling. We actually competed together in the 1980 Olympic trials. She's been around a while. And this is going to be a fun routine. This isn't actually her competitive routine. It's a very jazzy routine. To Jailhouse Rock. Anyone that knows Kelly's normal style in floor exercise knows that this is a little bit different for her, and she's going to have some fun with it. Double twist. It's definitely an exhibition routine.
A routine that she acknowledged a couple of hours ago to you that she was adding and subtracting from this afternoon. Just maybe an hour before this one got underway.
But she's motioning someone over there. I think she found a cutie. Oh, double tuck, landed a little short.
Now it looks like she's found Kevin Davis.
That's who she was motioning over. He's gonna do a little jitterbug. He told me earlier, he goes, I can't do this.
This is our final opportunity to see these Olympic gymnasts before Seoul, and I guarantee you that is a routine you will not see come the 88 Olympic Summer Games. But as far as showmanship goes, a perfect 10.
And we're looking at her tumbling pass. She just opted to do a nice high double twist.
again, just for exhibition reasons. No, I don't think we will see this in Seoul. I don't think this will be allowed.
No mixed doubles, huh? Well, coming up in a moment here at Charlotte, we will see a real exciting event. The high bar is the place. Charlie Lakes is the athlete who will be performing for us next on USA. Well, there, a very nice gesture by the folks here in Charlotte putting on this event, and well received by the people here at the new Coliseum. An introduction of the Olympic gymnastic coaches. Bella Caroli, Mark Lee from the right, Becky Buick, Marta Caroli, the assistant of the men's team, Yochi Tomita, along with A.B. Grossfeld, and Bill and Donna Strauss. How about the new coaching system that has seemingly been installed now, Kathy, for the women's team as we look ahead to the 88 games?
Well, it's always been divided opinion upon how the Olympic team should be coached, as I said earlier. And they're all excited because they can now go with their own individual athletes, train them right up until the time they walk out on the floor. Now, what's yet to be decided is who actually will go on the floor with the gymnast. And I think that will be decided here, the two. And they did say, though, that it would be more or less a figurehead position, that everybody is actually the coach. They will all share the responsibility equally, and that the two out on the floor will just be there to move the mats and get the kids ready.
It probably can be safely said that once this young man takes the floor, he's about the only one that helps himself. Charlie Lakes.
And this is the event that Charlie himself feels he can win a medal on. And there's not many people that disagree. He has an uncanny ability to get way up over the high bar in his release moves. And you see the first one right here, way up, a high front flip. And another one, reverse hex. And a double layout dismount. Beautifully done. Nailed the dismount, but you can see the height he gets off the high bar. It's unbelievable.
Well, take a look at the upper body on this guy, and you'll see where a lot of that spring comes from. He is an imposing physical specimen.
Now watch his front flip. Way up over the bar.
Wow. And, we got one
and as our announcer just said, wow. That's all you can say about this routine. And the form is perfect.
And finally, after all that excitement, the dismount.
This is called instant replay. As soon as it's over, we get on with our next competitor.
And he lifts up. Now, usually he does a triple back here. The double layout is just as beautiful. And again, going for every single tenth of a point, a stuck dismount.
This next gentleman, as we said,
Charlie Lakes. Number one in the all-around and in the high bar at Salt Lake City. Also tied for first in the parallel bars. And on the pommel horse was in the top three as well. Down the line we go. Number five in the all-around at Salt Lake City was Lance Ringnall. The horizontal bar, one of his two favorite events. He also loves to exercise on the floor.
And only 19 years old and going to the Olympic Games. Incredible feat.
Lives in Albuquerque, incoming freshman into that great program at Nebraska.
What I like to see here is very early on, he began working on his form. Straight legs, pointed toes, long, beautiful lines. Everything working toward perfect technique. And a double twisting, double back, laid out, unbelievable. That is such a difficult dismount. That dismount is one of the hardest dismounts being done today. This is release move, a reverse hex, perfect distance from the bar, right into the second one. Many of the Eastern Europeans are doing two and three release moves in a row. Now watch this dismount. The height up above the bar, and he wraps that twist so tight, stays in perfect body position.
Boy, as far as the men are concerned, what is more exciting than watching them perform on and then off the high bar? Charlie Lakes and Lance Ringnall. We'll pause for a break here. Coming up in a moment, the number one female gymnast in the USA, Phoebe Mills, takes to the floor here in Charlotte. Back here in Charlotte at the Carolinas Invitational, as we're about to wrap up our exhibition this afternoon of women's and men's gymnastics. Last chance to see them before Seoul. Phoebe Mills will be performing on the floor exercise for us in a moment. Coming up next on USA, after we complete our gymnastics exhibition this afternoon, is Jan Michael Vincent, Ernest Borgnine, starring in Airwolf, and the world's most famous game also almost never happened, the amazing true story of the first Olympics, Athens, 1896. That's coming up Tuesday, August 23rd at 8 o'clock, 7 Central on USA. The number one gymnast in the USA on the female side, and I have a feeling we're about to get another dose of the Adams family here.
Very interesting music choice. We have a lot of fun with it. First tumbling pass. Pipe, full twisting double back. You can't do it any better than that. Her physical conditioning is superb. They work on every minor detail.
Such a nice presence on the floor. Kathy, I know you and others believe how important that is when trying to relate to that crowd, judges watching.
Whip over to double back. Another very difficult move. She's added that. We'll twist some back hands for you. It's so important to have that presence. She has good posture, good toe point, and really connects with the audience. Last tumbling run, and another double back. See how every landing is just right there.
Phoebe Mills, who moved to Houston, Texas from Northfield, Illinois at the age of 11 to work with Bella Caroli. The style described as unemotional, very confident, has been compared to Nadia in that respect, but lots of personality out there, and that's very important at the Olympic Games.
All athletes in gymnastics must.
She's very focused this Olympic year. Began back at the American Cup and then on through the USA Championships.
And quite often that counts for 50%.
She knows exactly what she wants, and she's going after it.
We thought it would be fun for you, probably for the last time.
What's so nice about Phoebe is every position is just so perfect. It was a whip over through to a double back. She gets a nice height off the floor. And she finishes strong, where it's harder to do these types of tumbling passes at the end of your routine. She gets way up in the air.
Wonderful floor routine from Phoebe Mills. And something that you don't normally get a real good look at as we televise gymnastics, and that is the Olympic compulsory routine, something that everyone has to go through, and it'll be performed for the benefit of you and the crowd here in Charlotte by the veteran Christy Phillips.
And I can't tell you how important compulsories are at the Olympics. It really sets the stage of where you're going to end up, because it's where you end up in the compulsories. You end up seated for optionals, and you want to be in that last rotation. The last rotation consists of four teams. And it's rarely ever happened. In fact, I'm not sure if it ever has, that someone has moved up in the standings after the compulsories, and definitely not moved from one rotation into the next.
Thank you.
Every move and compulsories have to be done just exactly as written in the text. Everything has to be precise, balance perfect. And it's not that the moves are so difficult in terms of risk, but everything has to be so perfectly on that if you're out of position, there are deductions. Will be the last year of this compulsory. We'll have new compulsories right after the 88 games. The last time around, needs to show amplitude. The final turn, finishing balance. And well done.
Christy Phillips performing the Olympic compulsory routine. We'll have some final thoughts for you on our gymnastics portion from Charlotte in just a moment. Welcome back to Charlotte, the Carolinas Invitational. The Olympic teams, the men's and the women's squad, on the floor, so are the coaches. A final goodbye to the fans that have cheered them on here this afternoon. And pretty soon it'll be on to Seoul for the 88 Olympic Games. Kathy Johnson, I guess the big question to ask at this point, as you are such a trained observer and a former participant at this level, a lot of folks want to know how these men and women are going to do against that great international competition over in Korea.
Well, first of all, I can almost guarantee that they will improve their last world ranking, which was 6th for the women and 9th for the men. I know that their goal is to hit 8 for 8 for the women and 12 out of 12 routines for each of the men, and if they do that, they will be in a fight for 3rd place, but with about 4 other teams. So they have an outside shot at maybe a bronze medal. But I tell you what, if they're in the top 5, that would indeed be a success for the United States.
Okay, so an Olympic overview of the 88 U.S. men's and women's gymnastics team. Kathy, it's been a pleasure to watch these outstanding athletes with you here today. And I don't think, Ted Robinson, that any Olympic athletes better exemplify the personal sacrifice and hard work that goes into making the Olympic team any better than do these gymnasts that we've watched here this afternoon.
Thank you very much, Bob Carpenter and Kathy Johnson. Very nice job guiding us through the 2 hours here. One of the things that's so striking sitting here is a major contrast between last night in this new Charlotte Coliseum and this afternoon. Last night with the men's Olympic basketball team, it was competition. Competition against the NBA All-Stars and competition for spots on a team. There wasn't a whole lot of enjoyment from the players' standpoint. Fans certainly did. The people in Charlotte certainly got a lot of enjoyment out of this exhibition again today. My goodness, didn't the Olympic gymnasts try to give some of that enjoyment back. Don't forget, coming up on USA Sports tonight, our coverage of the Carolinas Invitational continues. At 9 o'clock Eastern, the Olympic boxing team, 6 members, meeting members of the Canadian Olympic team. Tomorrow at 6 o'clock, it's Criterion Cycling through the streets of Charlotte. 7:30 Eastern, the Olympic baseball team wraps up a 7-game series against the Cuban national team. We'll see you at 9 o'clock tonight from the Charlotte Coliseum. I'm Ted Robinson. So long for USA Sports. Today's coverage of the Carolinas Invitational has been brought to you by Meineke Discount Muffler Shops. You're not going to pay a lot at Meineke.